All yours.
Dr. Sanjeev Kumar, welcome, sir. Good evening, everyone. I believe you can listen to my voice, and I'll. Sure. So, good evening, everyone. Today we have gathered here on the Zoom platform, a virtual platform in the COVID times. Dr. Sumant, ask Ravi to mute everyone.
Ravindra, mute everyone, please, sure, except sir. Dr. Gupta.
Yeah, not going, sir.
Yeah, may I?
Good to go. Please, sir.
Ravi, give me a small signal whenever everybody is a mute.
Everyone is on mute, sir.
Okay. So, good evening, everyone. On behalf of API Faridabad, during COVID times, it was difficult to meet physically. So, we just decided that let us revive the API. We last met in December 1918 on that Haryana Epicon conference held at Taj Vivanta. After that, we were not able to maintain the tempo. And then we just thought that let us revive and the API forum. And we thought that let's start with the COVID pandemic. We started somewhere in March in India, and it has taken a monstrous shape right now. We are having almost a huge number of patients every day. It is a new disease. It is a novel coronavirus. Everyone knows that. And a lot of water has gone through Ganges since the pandemic started in India. Initially, we were not having a lot of knowledge about the disease, but as the time has passed by, we have been learning a lot of things about the COVID disease, the pathophysiology of it, the clinical spectrum with which the patients are passing through, the difficulties which the physicians face, or the challenges which we find in the day-to-day practice, whether we are in primary practice or we are doing a secondary practice or we are in the tertiary care setup. A lot of new drugs and new strategies have evolved with the COVID-19. And today we have gathered a galaxy of speakers who will be speaking their experiences in Faridabad, particularly on the COVID disease spectrum. We have Dr. Arvind Mins from Sarvodaya Hospital, who will be presenting some interesting cases which we have seen through. We'll be having Dr. Manisha with us, who is a pulmonologist at Sarvodaya Hospital, who will be dealing with the drugs, whether we can, how can we juggle around with the drugs. Then we have Dr. Shikha Pamar with us, who is intensivist again with us. And since the people who become critical ultimately land up in the critical area, so how do we handle the critical care situations in COVID? One more aspect has been the diabetes as the most common comorbid conditions. And as we use a lot of steroids to treat COVID, there is a stress hyperglycemia, as well as we have got a lot of challenges in controlling the blood sugars within the normal range. So on these all aspects, we'll be having a galaxy of speakers, as I just mentioned. The last speaker on diabetes would be Dr. R.V.S. Bhalla from Fortis Escorts. And then Dr. Sanjeev Kapoor will be giving us the take-home messages as how can we tackle this particular disease to reduce the mortality. I feel that the mortality figures have been going down as the pandemic is progressing. Although the numbers are scaring, they are increasing day in and day out. But luckily, the mortalities are going down. I don't know whether the virus is changing the virulence, whether the virulence is becoming less, or is the physician's side is becoming more intelligent in handling the disease. Somewhere I feel that at times people behave in a very good way, the patients behave in a very good way, and they come out. But at times, whatever we do, whether we do give a very good drug in the form of favipiravir or remdesivir, or whether we use an anti-inflammatory, or whether we use plasma therapy, whatever we do, the patient, we just lose the patient. And there have been secondary cytokine storms. Suddenly the patient will come going to cytokine storm. The patient which appears to be doing apparently well and is destined to be discharged, and they suddenly become sick, and then we lose them. We don't know what exactly is happening. So let's learn from the speakers, the learned speakers, to share their experiences as to what exactly has evolved in last 6 months or so about the COVID disease in India, more so in NCR, more so in Faridabad. So I'll request our first speaker, Dr. Arvind Mins, to share his experiences with some interesting cases which he has seen through where probably we have won or where probably we have lost the battle against COVID. So over to Dr. Ravindra Arvind Mins to start his presentation, please. Dr. Mins is a senior physician with us in Sarvodaya Hospital, and he has been working very hard in the last 4 or 5 months fighting with the COVID patients. Dr. Mins, please.
Thank you, sir. Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. The dusk of 2019 and the dawn of 2020 saw a new nightmare come to life, a serious nightmare which put a daunting task in front of intensivists, internists, and pulmonologists. This is what we came to know as a corona pneumonia, COVID pneumonia. Now, there was some morbid inclination, attraction, and challenge which was definitely there to vis-a-vis dealing with it. Next slide, please. I would want you guys to have a look in the couple of next 4 slides very carefully. And here I have just put up my thought processes dealing in the experience we've had in the last 4-5 months. Next slide, sir. And yet again, next slide. And next slide. Now, interestingly, none of these slides are COVID pneumonia. But if we were to reflect on it, it looks exactly the similar what we are dealing in last almost 5 to 6 months. Next slide, please. Now, this is what a COVID pneumonia. The idea of bringing in the earlier 4 slides and comparing this with the present slide is to show how this pneumonia isn't new to us. There's a beautiful, one can look at those beautiful atoll signs with center clearing and halo around it, the galaxy signs over here, which the classical COVID has, along with the subpleural sparing. Earlier, whenever we've had this kind of radiological expressions, we have always thought in terms of cryptogenic organizing pneumonia, we have thought in terms of hypersensitivity interstitial pneumonia or drug-induced interstitial pneumonia. The idea of sharing this thought process is here where we've thought what we are dealing with, a COVID pneumonia, is slightly different but not unknown to us in the past. Next, please. Now, interestingly, though it's a viral pneumonia, but the instance of bacterial superimpositions is very not common, not that we have seen in our ICU in Sarvodaya. I'm yet to encounter one with a superadded bacterial thing. It's a rapidly progressive, destructive, and predominantly interstitial lung disease, and yet self-limiting. Once one goes through it, pause, period. Then all we need to do is deal with the consequences. Agreed, it's prone to cytokine storm. Agreed, it predisposes to microvascular thrombosis. But then if one were to extrapolate it to a COP or a drug-induced pneumonitis or hypersensitive pneumonitis or any other interstitial pneumonia, it does behave and like that. Next, please. So with this thought process, we started treating our patients, though the initial couple of weeks were very tough, since there was a cynicism about the steroids and WHO being very vehemently against it. However, the discovery did prove and gave us a very strong support that steroids definitely made a 35% difference in mortality. So here, what we have been doing, we have been using antivirals. Remdesivir has been on the forefront, and along with steroids, which we were kind of very scared to use in the earlier phase of the diseases. But thereafter, as the confidence keep building up, we became more and more liberal with it. The other immunosuppression that I'm talking about, I'll express about more in terms of the immunosuppression later on. All of them have been on anticoagulations day one, and which has been stepped up depending on the D-dimer values. Cytokine storms, yes, we have used atezolizumab, tocilizumab, and in fact, ibrutinib also in some instances. And yes, we have been using antifibrotic agents like pirfenidone right from the very beginning. Next, please. Now, before I go on any further, the slide was here meant to show that these were the young healthcare workers we've had in our hospitals, which presented with pneumonia within a week of it. A slide to on the right-hand side shows this patch ground glassing coming in over, and within 4 days, along with remdesivir and steroid, there was absolute clearing. Next one, please. Similar, emphasizing the same thing, within 3 to 4 days, like 48 to 96 hours, we had achieved major clearing. Now, whether this is really the steroids or really the plasma, it's too premature and the conjunction to actually think about. But then it really gives a big time hope over here. Next one. This is what, again, another young patient definitely presenting rest around 10 days after the illness, and we used plasma over here, and within 48 hours we had a clearing of this. So it does reduce the duration of hospitalization in all these patients which we have used plasma in the early stages. Next one. Now, these patients, there are a couple of more, two or three of the slides lined up over here. These were the very early ones, the very early patients in which there was a huge hype of tocilizumab, itolizumab, and there was cytokine storm. So here we were kind of a bit reluctant using higher doses steroid, but then the slide on the left was dated June 26th, and now you have in August 10th, there has been a remarkable changes over here. Though the patient is asymptomatic, but then there were some irreversible changes which has happened and yet to recover from. Next one, please. Similar slides, similar dates, but the one dated August 10 definitely looks much more encouraging than the depressing slide on the left-hand side. And next one, sir. This is the CT of the last slide we have seen. This is just around a couple of days back, and remarkable changes have been noticed in this one. And to further collaborate it with the PFT, next one, please. This is what the PFT has been like. Though there have been a marked restrictive pattern over here, with the marked diffusion capacity being affected. Next one, please. Another comparison between slides, starting from the right-hand side to the extreme left, how we started off this one in June and thereafter, it worsened, and now this is the last slide that we are looking on the left-hand side. Definitely very heart-rendering one. Next one. The same patient with a PFT, with a definitely moderate restrictive defect and reduced diffusion capacity. And next one. This patient has been the most challenging one to me till date. I came across her in a very early part of June, and with absolute extensive disease. I picked this up patient for care was one patient in which I've had used pulse steroids. Very high dose methylprednisolone, 500 milligram over a period of 5 days. And the picture on the left depicts our present scenario. In this patient, how apart after this high steroid pulse, we went on oral steroids, but then the sugars were going haywire. So we resorted to mycophenolate, mofentil, and the end result is as there in the left side of the slide. Next one, please. Now, coming over to the atypical cases that we have recently have, like interestingly, most of them have been from outside Faridabad. This one I recall was a young male, 33-odd-ish age, was witness. Now, these people are very much against use of human albumin or platelets or blood products. So this gentleman presented with fever, body aches, and he came over with a negative report, but the CTs were probably quite suggestive of COVID pneumonia. We repeated the RT-PCR over here, and it definitely came out positive. Now, the dengue serology, the malarial antigens have been negative all throughout. His problem, because of his religious conviction, was a very low platelet count, roughly to the tune of 11,000. In absence of any other comorbidities or suggestion of another disease, we thought this might have been a presentation of COVID. However, in absence, because we couldn't do a bone marrow in the present scenario, other diseases definitely need to be looked at before we can actually say this was the presentation of COVID. But yes, definitely he had a mild lung involvement, a positive PCR, and a severe thrombocytopenia, which responded pretty well to steroids. He was sent home happily. Next one, please. This again is a confirmation of symptoms. Or a very 69-year-old woman was shifted a couple of days back from Panchkula with severe abdominal pain, hypoxemia, and the CT as on the top panel, which was quite suggestive of COVID. This woman, she's a non-diabetic, hypertensive, and there she had a subacute intestinal obstruction, which in the lower panel, if we look at, there was a thrombus in a SMA. So she had mesenteric ischemia with COVID-like picture on the CT, hypoxemia, and thereafter she went into a severe cytokine crisis, which could be because of the mesenteric ischemia per se, but her D-dimers went right up to 3,500, the IL-6 of 5,000, CRP shot through the roof to almost 250. So again, we are working more to prove if this was a typical presentation of COVID causing microthrombi or a coincidental mesenteric thrombus along with the COVID pneumonia. So she was in septic shock, MODS, and still trying to pull through it. Next one. Now, this is the last of the series that I want to talk about. This gentleman was symptomatic since almost around 25th of August. He presented to us, he's a diabetic, a fever, body aches, tested positive for COVID, and had a very minimal CT score. The CT on the panel right now is the CT with which we discharged him from the hospital, with absolutely acceptable inflammatory markers and near normal CT, which hardly showed any patch after the usual routine of remdesivir and steroids. Interestingly, 3 days after discharge, he just complained of palpitation. And on examination and for investigation, he's had an atrial fibrillation, non-hypoxic atrial fibrillation with a normal cardiac markers, troponin T's, CPK-MBs, and pro-BNP, and a normal echo. We started him on Cordoron, and he was medically rewarded from Cordoron, and it went into normal sinus rhythm. Till that time, he was absolutely asymptomatic, but then almost 17th day from the first illness, apparent illness from which he was discharged from, he threw up a fever. And now, this time when we scanned him, there is another patch, a fresh patch which came up. Along with that, the classical beautiful atoll sign on the bottom panel. So again, since he has been with remdesivir, he was positive, still tested for PCR for the COVID, and he still was positive for PCR. So we started him on steroids, gave him some plasma therapy. He's still with us and seems to be apparently doing fine. So these are a small collection that I have tried to share with the thought process. Yes, we were cynical, we were scared, but then we went full extreme ahead with the steroids, with antivirals. And subsequently, a vast majority of patients, we have had a wonderful results. Just with a word of caution that yes, with a more understanding, we are now electively intubating patients. Because even with a very high flow nasal oxygen, there's the risk and the danger of oxidant injuries and subsequent fibrosis secondary to the oxygen per se has also been high on our minds. So that's all I have to present, Sir Dr. Gupta. I think
that's
one. And thank you for all of us for being with me.
Thank you, Dr. Mins, for sharing your experiences with us. And we have seen a number of cases this way. I'm sure that other clinicians who have been dealing with the COVID are having even wider spectrum of the cases. This was a small snapshot which we had in Sarvodaya Hospital. And whenever the time permits in some other meeting, we'll be sharing some more clinical spectrum. The spectrum has been from 0 to 100, from very mild, asymptomatic, to very severe patients with whom we have lost. So now we move on to Dr. Manisha Mendiratta, who is a pulmonologist with us. She will be dealing with the drugs, whatever drugs have evolved over the last 6 months. So Dr. Mendiratta, please.
So good evening, all. Dr. Mins, you had presented with the amazing case presentations with atypical type of presentations also. But actually what worked, what did not in all these cases is still a query. As we know that no drugs or biologicals have been approved by FDA for treatment of COVID, although there have been some emergency authorization for use of some drugs. But it has been 6 months we have been trying drugs with no proven efficacy, with no proven antivirals, antiviral role. Let me start with a simple case. A patient present. Next, please, Ravindra. So a simple patient, a mild symptomatic patient, present to us with a fever, cough, throat pain, and the vitals and hemodynamically patient was stable with a COVID RT-PCR. Next. So as per the classification, the patient fits into a mild patient. So now the option is whether we need to start this patient on treatment or the patient is an mild patients which falls into the 80% of the patients which otherwise also improve with the drugs. So we'll follow this patient to another 5 to 7 days and see how the progression things happens. So Ravindra, be little faster. So patient falls into a mild symptomatic patient and the treatment options would be HCQs, azithromycin, doxycycline, ivermectin, and favipiravir. So the treatment options, most common is the HCQs, which has got conflicting results, although in some of the studies and JAMA has proved that although it increases QTc intervals, but it has decreased mortality from 18% to 40%, which is a significant amount of decrease in the percentage of the immunity. Next. Then they say that this drug should only be used after shared decision making the patient while awaring results of the ongoing studies. So the doses, everyone is aware, 400 milligram BD on day one and followed by 200 BD for next 4 days. Next. So then came another drug which was called ivermectin. It is an anti-parasite drug. So the drug was projected as FDA approved drug. So let me make it clear that this drug is FDA approved for an anti-parasitic role and not for a COVID. Although it was projected that it is a FDA approved drug which inhibits the replication. So this was FDA approved for parasitic infections and not for COVID. So this drug has been widely available and we have a great experience of using it. So due to inclusion on the WHO model list of essential medicines, with no toxicity, we started using these drugs. So ivermectin in combination with the HCQs for 5 days, although the results were not satisfactory, but since there were no side effects or the minimal side effects, the combination is still being carried out for mild symptomatic patients. Next. So this article shows that ivermectin is associated with lower mortality, but this is just a preprint and it has not been yet peer reviewed. So we cannot consider as an approved drug. Next. So Bangladesh doctors have claimed to find drug combinations to treat COVID. The drug combinations include doxycycline, ivermectin, HCQs. Next, please. Next. So UP has gone regarding like ivermectin, they have included it in all patients and even as a prophylaxis in contacts of COVID-19 patients and even in the prophylaxis of healthcare workers. Next. So the only oral antiviral which has been approved is favipiravir. Although that drug came with a bang because that was the only antiviral drug, although it was an emergency approved drug, and oral antiviral. So we started it in almost all the patients from moderate to severe disease. Though the drug is approved only for mild to moderate patients and that too in initial 1 week of the infection. Because if we try to understand the mechanism, it basically acts on the replication of the virus. So once the virus has replicated in the first week, there is not much use of starting this drug in severe or late stages of the COVID-19. Next. Next. So there have been trials among favipiravir plus others, other antiviral drugs like lopinavir and ritonavir combination, which was initially approved for the COVID-19 infection. Next. So favipiravir was not associated with any decreased rate of symptomatic improvement or dyspnea or overall respiratory failure rate or any ICU admission. Next. So considering the emergency and unmet medical need for COVID-19 disease, it has been approved restricted emergency use. Now another drugs come into the action are the injectable antiviral. The only injectable antiviral is remdesivir. So we saw that favipiravir is limited to the mild to moderate cases, and the remdesivir has been advised only for moderate cases. And we are, since we don't have any other antiviral drugs, we are using it for severe cases. Next. So insufficient data to recommend either for or against any treatment in mild cases. So mild cases, we usually don't need antiviral drugs. Next. So this is the same patient. The patient was, since the symptoms persisted and fever was there, so patient was given a favipiravir with a loading dose of 1800 HCQs, paracetamol, vitamin C, and since patient had a history of hypoxia, so we started him on low molecular heparin. So the whole basket of the COVID treatment mainly includes the antivirals, the blood thinners, and the steroids. I think Dr. Mintz, most of the cases have been taken care of by steroids. As you told that it is just like any other interstitial lung disease. I agree. It is like any other lung fibrosis kind of disease. But the progression of the disease is rapid. So we need higher doses. We need multiple drugs which work at multiple sites to prevent the progression of the disease. So next. So then comes the role of the steroid, a recovery trial. When the steroids came, it was almost like a miracle drug. They said Dexona has proved to decrease the mortality. Though we have been using these steroids in any pneumonias with sepsis, we had already been using steroids. But since these people have documented and taken efforts to put patients into trial, they proved that Dexona has been able to decrease the mortality rate significantly. Next. So on the basis of the preliminary report from the recovery trial, the panel recommends using dexamethasone 6 mg per day for up to 10 days for the treatment of COVID-19 in patients who are mechanically ventilated and in patients who require supplemental oxygen but who are not mechanically ventilated. So the panel recommends against using dexamethasone for the treatment of COVID-19 who do not require supplement. So before starting the steroids, the main consideration should be hypoxia and CT involvement. Next. So next is plasma therapy. What actually works in plasma, or what is the basis of giving plasma, we all are aware. So in last 4-5 months, since we have started using plasma and we are using a cocktail of all the drugs, we cannot say authentically that actually plasma has been working. But there have been different trials, like plasma has been used since long for different diseases. We started using it as a part of therapy in COVID-19 with controversial results. Next. So this is the first living update, which included 20 patients and 16 were on 16 non-controlled. So we saw that 5211 received convalescent plasma and identified a further 98 ongoing studies including convalescent plasma. Yet the results have been controversial, and the normal question when we advise patients to start give convalescent or arrange for a plasma is whether patient will improve with this plasma. So even we are not sure about it, what is working, but yes, one of the therapy which has to be included in all patients from moderate. So even the recommendation says that the plasma is not meant for severe patient, or once the patient is mechanically ventilated, plasma does not work for critically ill patients. Next. These are all the studies which are uncertain whether convalescent plasma prolongs any time to death or any all-cause mortality or any improvement in the clinical symptoms also. Next. So next is, if the patients, even after giving all these drugs of antiviral, steroids and plasma, is not improving, and we find that there is a inflammatory storm, or what we call a cytokine storm, since the whole mechanism and the cascade for the inflammation includes interleukin 6, and we have IL-6, anti-IL-6. So the drugs which we use are usually tocilizumab, itolizumab. These drugs are usually given after we have proved that there is no superadded infection. Since these are immunosuppressant drugs, we need to rule out that there is no underlying sepsis, and has to be given only when we see that the patient has increased markers, which are specified by increased ferritin. Next, please. Which is increased ferritin, increased IL-6, and with the increasing trend. Next, please. Next. So, in patients with coronavirus disease, since we have patient progresses to a severe disease, we start with the controlling the cytokine storm with IL-6 markers, and there have been another drugs also which works on these cascades, like IL-4 markers suppressors also, interleukin I beta marker suppressor also. Next, please. Next. So this patient, as we follow, he was then shifted to ICU. The saturations fell down to 84%. There were increase in the D-dimers and IL-6. Next. So we had the options of adding tocilizumab or itolizumab, which is one of the anti-inflammatory drug. Next. So another part of the therapy, not pharmacological, but oxygen is one of the important or the pillar for the treatment of the patients who land up into moderate to severe disease, because the most common cause of mortality is hypoxia per se, and the only treatment we have is to supplement the oxygen in whatever way, like we can step up from oxygen to full face mask to high flow nasal cannulas to NIV, whatever works to compensate for the hypoxia. Next. So these are few recommendations for the antivirals also. Next. So as I have already told, that once there is a cytokine storm and the role of the IL-6 and its inhibitors. Next. So initially the tocilizumab was used in almost every patient who goes into cytokine storm with increased markers. But in due course, the trials have been conducted, and they have proven that tocilizumab rather suppresses the immunity, and it has no proven effect even in the cytokine storm. The anti-inflammatory role of steroid has proven far more better than these drugs like tocilizumab. Next. So this is the main slide which focuses on the timing of the treatment. So in the whole course of the disease, the most important thing is the timing of the treatment. If we actually change our therapy during the progression of the disease, we can stop the progression at that point. Suppose, as I just told, that antivirals, they'll act on the first week since they suppress the viral replication. So the plasma will also help during the first 7 to 10 days of the therapy, because after that patient will start developing his own antibodies. Then the immunomodulators, adjuvants, once the patient lands into an ARDS or is on a ventilatory support, I think by day 14, none of the drugs other than steroid or anti-inflammatory will help in stopping the progression of the disease. Next. That's all for the treatment part. There is a wide basket of all the antiviral, all the therapies for COVID-19 with no proven drug and no proven efficacy of any of the drugs. So we have to be very judicious regarding the drug options and considering the side effects of all the drugs. Thank you. Dr. Gupta, please unmute yourself.
Yeah, thank you, Dr. Manisha, for sharing the details on the drugs. I believe your last slide was the carry home message. Depending on the phase of the disease, whether we are early in the phase of the disease where the antiviral drugs are going to work, and then the cytokine storm to be addressed in the next phase. And finally, I believe you have probably missed the antifibrotic drugs as well, because once these two phases are over, the patients who is in the third week or fourth week and it's not doing well, even with the NIV or maybe even on the ventilator, and the lungs go into the fibrotic stage, there also we need to address at that particular part. So we as clinicians need to understand which particular phase of the disease are we going to address and with what particular drug. You have very clearly elaborated all the drugs in various phases. Now we move on to the critical care aspect of the disease. And for that, we have got Dr. Shikha Pawar with us, who is an associate director in the Department of Critical Care Medicine at Sarvodaya Hospital, and has been working very, very hard to save our patients. And there has been a very lot of controversy amongst us whether to ventilate or not to ventilate, whether to keep the patient on NIV alone or whether to electively early intubate. That's the question. I believe Dr. Shikha will be discussing this particular part and the other aspects of critical care in COVID-19 disease. Over to Dr. Shikha. Dr. Shikha, you need to unmute yourself.
Ravi, can you unmute Dr. Shikha and give us light share rights, please?
Sure, sir. I have already given her light share rights.
Dr. Shikha, please unmute yourself.
Please unmute, ma'am, please.
Sir, ma'am is already unmuted. Already.
Ma'am, are you there?
Hello, ma'am. We are not able to hear you. I'm asking. Yeah, okay. Now you are unmuted. Are you using any hands-free with your laptop or your system? Ma'am, we are not able to hear you.
Dr. Shikha, ma'am, ma'am, are you there?
No, ma'am, still you are not audible. Ma'am, you are still not audible. Ma'am, is it possible if I can present and you can join from your mobile?
Ravindra, Ravi,
yes sir.
Can we have Dr. Bhalla sir's slides first? Dr. Shikha will join next, please.
Sure, sir.
Dr. Gupta, sir.
I was going to say that if there's a technical difficulty, I can invite Dr. Bhalla. Yeah. So let's invite Dr. Bhalla. As I was going to discuss, that diabetes is the most common comorbid condition which we are dealing amongst with the COVID patients. And the use of steroids becomes a cornerstone of therapy in many of the patients. So that leads to one, either stress hypoglycemia in patients who have been non-diabetic in the past, or people who are diabetic, their diabetes control goes haywire. The sugars, they fly through the roof. So let's listen from Dr. Bhalla, his experience of using steroids and how to tackle the diabetes in all the spectrum of the COVID patients. Over to Dr. Bhalla. Dr. Bhalla is a very close friend and is a senior consultant HOD at the Department of Medicine at Fortis Escorts Hospital, Faridabad. So, Dr. Bhalla, please.
Good evening, sir, and thank you very much for the kind words. It is a bit come down to earth kind of thing after listening to the great talks on how to manage COVID disease, which is a hot topic nowadays, but then diabetes itself is one complication which cannot be forgotten during the course of COVID disease. Next slide, please. So why should we study diabetes in COVID? Next, please. Yeah, so we see that among the comorbidities that are associated with COVID, although hypertension ranks the first, but diabetes comes close behind at number two. Next, please. Yeah, if you look at the severe versus non-severe, which is in gray, is the severe one, then we find that severe COVID disease is seen much more likely to be seen in patients with diabetes than in those who don't have diabetes. Next slide, please. And the prevalence of non-survivors versus survivor, again, there is a 10 to 15% difference in survival among patients, those who have diabetes, as compared to those who don't have diabetes. Next, please. So the impact of diabetes in COVID-19 would be can be summarized as that 20 to 50% of patients with COVID-19 have diabetes, and those with diabetes have an increased incidence of severe complications, and up to 2/3 of the mortality in Italian patients was seen in diabetics. Next, please. So what is the link between diabetes and COVID? We know that acute hyperglycemia upregulates the ACE2 receptors, while chronic hyperglycemia downregulates them. We know, everyone knows, I'm sure by now, that ACE2 receptors are the points of the first interaction between the COVID virus and the human body. And it is by attaching to these receptors, the COVID virus is able to gain access to the cells. In acute hyperglycemia per se would lead to a higher incidence of COVID virus being able to attach and affect in a greater manner. And though chronic hyperglycemia downregulates the ACE2 receptors, but is this downregulation itself is considered to be deleterious in the way that it leads to more production of angiotensin 2, which is related to many of the serious adverse side effects which we are seeing in the later stage of the COVID illness. And secondly, levels of an enzyme called furin are also increasing in patients with diabetes. This furin mediates the internalization of the virion into the cell. That means after the cell COVID virus has attacked the cell, H2 receptor, it is taken inside the cell with the help of furin and other proteases, which allow it to enter the cell and then integrate itself into the cell. H2 is also expressed on beta cells. This is important because we are seeing many cases with fresh onset of diabetes. People have been presenting as diabetic ketoacidosis also, especially in Italy and US, although I have not seen any such case in India so far, in my practice so far. And we all know that diabetes is a state of immune dysfunction, especially if it is uncontrolled. There are defects in the antigen presenter cells. The T cells may be decreased both in number as well as in function. And there is decrease in interferon gamma production, which prevents against viral infections. Diabetes and obesity often coexist, and both of them have been proven to be serious factors for adverse events in COVID disease. So diabetes is a state where there is a chronic low-grade inflammation with increased levels of IL-6, which is one of the cytokines which has been implicated in serious outcomes in COVID. As well as that, obese patients have a respiratory compromise and are more likely to be unable to cope with the severe disease if it happens in them. It is common that diabetes is not something which comes alone. Right from the time of metabolic syndrome, if you go further ahead, as the patient ages, especially in the elderly, there may be a host of comorbidities like hypertension, coronary artery disease, coronary heart failure, which all lead to adverse outcomes in a COVID patient. Next, please. So I would try to divide my talk into three stages as to it is not only in the acute phase that we need to watch out for diabetes. We need to prepare the patient before the onset of illness to help him prevent having a serious outcome in the pre-COVID stage. And then in the COVID stage, we need to devise a way of tackling the mild cases and a different way for the moderate to severe cases, and I'll go according to that schedule. So in the pre-COVID illness, what should one do? We should try to optimize the diabetic therapy so that the patient is maintaining HbA1c close to 7, and if we have access to CGM, then it should be time in range should be around 70% with less than 4% hypoglycemia. We should not be discontinuing established therapy. Although we know that certain drugs like SGLT2 inhibitors may be harmful in a patient with COVID, it doesn't mean that if a person is doing well on SGLT2, just because the COVID is around the bend, we should go ahead and stop the SGLT2 and let his control deteriorate. We should educate our patients, and this is very, very important, I feel, about sick day rules, that they have to take plenty of fluids, they have to monitor their sugars frequently. They have to look out for warning signs like increased frequency of micturition, increased thirst, and to be able to recognize decay symptoms like nausea, vomiting, and fruity odor. So once they know that things are worsening, or they can monitor the ketones also in heuristics, so then they will be much more aware, and they will present to us earlier rather than in a bad state. Diet and exercise, of course, one need not stress, cannot stress too much. They are always important. And the role of telemedicine, I think everyone of us is using telemedicine nowadays, and is especially helpful to monitor diabetes and to help the patients maintain adequate control. Vaccination in diabetes, we should be trying to vaccinate for flu because it is around the corner. And those people who haven't been vaccinated against pneumonia also should be vaccinated. Next, please. So if we look at the management of diabetes in mild or moderate COVID, I would just be talking about the individual OHAs, because there is a lot of confusion which OHA I should be using or which I should not be using. And unfortunately, there are not much of clarity has been thrown on this issue, despite a lot of webinars and discussions and articles. So metformin, being the oldest OHA in use, it has some immunomodulatory properties. which have been proven in patients with Legionella pneumonia as well as in HCV infections. It has shown a good effect. So we can continue in patient with mild disease, especially if there is no nausea vomiting. However, if the patient has got poor oral intake or there is hepatic or renal compromise, or the patient has got hypotension, then we know that it can lead to lactic acidosis and worse outcomes. So by and large, in very mild cases, yes. But in anything more than that, probably no. Next, please. Sulfonylureas or meglitinides. Again, there is a risk of hypoglycemia with poor oral intake. So if the person is not able to take orally properly, then we should discontinue. Next, please. What about pioglitazone? It's a drug which has been in and out of favor a lot of times. And it does have a lot of good qualities so far as immunomodulation is concerned. Again, it upregulates the ACE2 receptors, but it does not do so in the lung. It does only in the insulin-sensitive tissues. So it decreases the production of IL-6 and TNF from adipose tissues. This has also been proven. So they may be beneficial in patients with mild, moderate COVID. There is a trial underway to see the risk-benefit, but the results are not yet available. We have to avoid in patients with heart failure or those in whom we suspect of fluid overload. Next, please. SGLT2 inhibitors, there is a strong recommendation to discontinue all SGLT2 inhibitors in COVID patients because of the propensity to cause euglycemic decay and dehydration, worsening of acute kidney injury. But some people do feel that intuitively SGLT2s have been proven to be helpful in patients with CKD and as well as in heart failure. And we do see a lot of acute kidney injury and heart failure in COVID patients. So maybe there is a role. AstraZeneca is doing a trial with dapagliflozin in patients with COVID who have pre-established heart failure and CKD. The results will probably come out next year. Next, please. In alpha-glucosidase inhibitors, not very commonly used in the West, but we are very fond of using in India, especially because of our prandial sugar rise because of high carbohydrate intake. But I have not been able to find any definite recommendations, and probably we would not be using in COVID patients. Next, please. So coming to the role of DPP-4 inhibitors, we have to keep in mind that DPP-4 was a receptor for the MERS-CoV-2, although it has not been proven to be a receptor for SARS-CoV-2. That is one confounding agent point. Secondly, DPP-4 are supposed to increase the frequency of pharyngitis and in patients, but they have not been shown to increase the frequency of pneumonia. So by and large, it is recommended that if the patient is on DPP-4 inhibitors, we can continue. Next, please. GLP-1 receptor agonists, although they are not very commonly used in the Indian setting, few people are on weekly schedules. They have been prone to decrease the glucose variability. The hypoglycemia risk is low, but the delayed gastric emptying because of these drugs can cause problems in ICU patients. So probably in mild to moderate COVID, we can continue with GLP-1 receptor agonists if the patient is already on them. Next, please. So the drug of choice by and large for patients with COVID, because majority of them would be unstable because COVID itself causes what is known as COVID hyperglycemia. There is uncontrolled sugar levels, patients are present with decay, and the insulin requirements are very high. OHAs are often unable to control the sugars in such patients. So insulin remains the backbone of therapy for patients with COVID. Those who are already on insulin can continue with the previous dose in mild and moderate disease, but most would need a basal bolus multi-dose insulin regimen. Next, please. So in severe disease, intravenous insulin therapy is the treatment of choice. And we have to kind of upregulate the insulin therapy depending upon the serial blood sugar levels. It could be 1 hourly or 2 hourly monitoring. And depending on the decline in the blood sugar or the rise, there are various regimens which one can employ. and they are the ones and thus try to achieve a control so that the sugar range is somewhere between 100 to 180 most of the time. I know it is very difficult to control it for full 24 hours to have absolute perfect control, because if we try to have a too tight a control, we can land up in hypoglycemia, and lesser doses of insulin would obviously lead to hyperglycemia. We have to watch out for fluid overload and hypokalemia in severe disease, because hypokalemia per se is a feature in patients with COVID due to the increased levels of angiotensin. One problem which we can face, one challenge which might be there in patients with COVID whom we are monitoring for sugar, is that we have to use frequent readings of the glucometer and proper disinfection of the glucometer and use of disposable lancets for monitoring of blood sugar is highly recommended. If someone has got facility for CGM and report monitoring, which most of us don't have really, one can go for that. And any drugs which are commonly co-prescribed with anti-diabetic medications like ACE inhibitors, ARBs or statins have to be continued. This has been proven again. And if one is very much pressed for manpower, or one wants to reduce the use of glucometer or the contact between the patient and the staff, there have been use of subcutaneous 4-hourly regimens for even mild to moderate DKA, and this has been done practiced a lot in the USA, where what they have done is that patients who have had just a pH of not less than 7.1 and bicarbonates ranging from 10 to 18, and there they have used you know, mix of lantus as well as 4-hourly rapid acting insulin could be aspart or lispro, and 4-hourly doses, and depending on the patient phenotype, they have used a low dose of 0.6 units per kg per day to a total dose of 1.4 or even 2 units per kg per day. And as I said earlier, the target RBS has to be 100 to 180. So one regimen could be to use, if you want to use a low dose, then it could be 0.25 units per kg of lantus in a single dose, or 0.15 units per kg of NPH into divided doses, and 0.05 units per kg of NovoRapid or Humalog Lispro, rapid acting insulin, every 4-hourly, and then again increase the titrate the dose of you know, rapid acting insulin depending on the blood sugar level. We can up or down titrate by 20% if the sugar is not within the target range. This is one way of minimizing patient and staff contact and decreasing the spread of COVID. But yes, it is not a better alternative to intravenous insulin therapy, which is always the preferred modality of treatment in serious patients. Next, please. So the take-home messages would be that diabetes with COVID leads to increased severity and mortality. Always, as always, prevention is better than cure. Most of the OHAs can probably continue in mild disease, with the exception of SGLT2 inhibitors. Insulin is the treatment of choice in majority of admitted patients, and disinfection should be strictly practiced when the patient is admitted in the COVID setting. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Balla, for elaborating the drugs in the COVID-19 disease. In fact, I had insulin only in my mind, but you have very elaborately discussed all the OHAs, whether to continue or to discontinue in mild, moderate, and severe disease. I still believe that in mild to moderate disease, you can continue your current oral hypoglycemic regime. But people who are put on steroids will definitely have to go on to the insulin therapy. And we have seen patients going on to the infusion all the time. Sugar is not getting controlled even with the basal bolus regime very easily. And the requirements also go very, very high. Contribution both by COVID-19 disease as well as the steroids leading onto the uncontrolled diabetes. Well, thank you once again. And I believe that now we can invite Dr. Shikha for a session on to the critical care aspects of the disease. Dr. Shikha Pamar is Associate Director and Head of the Department of Critical Care Medicine at Sarvodaya Hospital. And she has got a very, very wide experience in handling with the COVID-19 critical patients. And as I was discussing, that one question needs to be answered, whether to ventilate or not to ventilate, whether to stay with the NIV or then to do elective intubation and electively ventilate. Over to Dr. Shikha, please.
A very, very good evening to everyone. I am so sorry for the earlier glitch. So yes, this has been a really tough time for all of us when emotions have really ran high and we also all feared for our lives and for the lives of our patients. But yes, we all are here sitting today and, you know, talking about our experiences. So we have become richer by 6 months now. So I will be talking about how to manage these patients once they land up into the critical care. So this is what actually happens when I get the patients in my ICU. Actually, already the viral phase is over. And once the viral phase is over, the patient enters in a completely inflammatory response phase. So this is the phase where actually the whole damage to the body is occurring and very rapid deterioration of the patient occurs. So I might get a patient who is like just in the phase two of the pulmonary phase. He's just getting hypoxic, he's getting infiltrates, or I might sometimes just get a patient who's completely, completely desaturating and nothing is working on that patient. How hard I try, how much FiO2 I give, how much an IV trial I give, we eventually fail in this patient. So that can be the spectrum. The wide spectrum can be this much, you know. So we'll be talking about all this wide spectrum of the cases, what we do. So coming to first thing, what I share, you know, always believe in is two things. First is primum non nocere. That means firstly, do no harm. Do no harm to the patient first. And now in this COVID era, I will say do no harm to your staff also. So these two things are very important. And they are, you know, the utmost first thing which I always take care, that safety comes first, both for my patients and both for the staff. And now here, I would like to, you know, press upon that despite taking all the safety measures, having the best of the personal protection equipment, taking all the precautions to prevent the aerosol generation, we did have some staff, our staff actually, we had some of our staff going down with the COVID, but eventually we pulled them all out. And so, you know, we are all good today. So taking all the precautions, and now the staff is pretty very well trained. So let's see all those safety measures, what we should take and how to proceed in the critical care. So coming to the first thing, that again, just as I've told you, that we might get a patient who is really hypoxic. So in these patients, to be really safe, we have to avoid aerosol generating procedures and the devices, because the more aerosol is going to get generated, more is the, you know, number of people will go down with those aerosols. So hypoxemia, it occurs really very significantly and sometimes really very fast. We have to keep a real tab on that. And then coming on to the intubation part, it is a very high aerosol generating procedure and the risk is pretty high for if we are not taking proper and adequate precautions. And despite precautions, full precautions also, because we are directly very close to the patient mouth, the risk is really high and we get a direct very high viral load and the chances of death really become high in these patients. Coming to the fluid management, we all are very well aware that we have only two approaches. Either we dry and fry, or else we wet and we drown the patient. So it's either fill and kill or dry or fry. But then we have to be really, you know, careful with both the things. We should not be following the both spectrums. So we have to maintain a very good fluid balance. So the norm has always been in ARDS to err on the, you know, wrong side. Maybe we will keep my patient a little underfilled, but not this much underfilled so that the patient lands up into AKI. So we have to really be juggle with the fluid management. And this, which we are clearly doing nowadays with the IVC assessment, and then we are using pulse pressure variation, systolic pressure variation. Then the periphery of the patient tells a lot of story. And then we are using BNP, Procal and BNP. BNP measurement is being done regularly so that, you know, if the patient goes in slightly positive balance and the lungs become congested, we actually get an idea, clear idea that the balance is not adequate. So we need to decongest the patient today. Or else we can keep a tab on the urea and the sodium of the patient. These are again, you know, two very good markers, because if the patient is running dry, sodium will jump and same will happen with the urea. So you can actually, you know, see these things happening in the patient real time. So we may require fluid resuscitation only in the subset of the patients who are going into sepsis. Otherwise, we err on the lower side. We keep our patients dry. So we have to also provide the adequate sedation and analgesia, but not too much of sedation. So nowadays, the norm is we just keep our patients awake, and RAS 0 to 2 is very much ideal. So if I tap a patient and I ask him please open your eyes. My patient should be actually able to open eyes. This is the amount of light sedation we give to our patients. The exception is only on the patients who are really very critical and who are on very high peak and for whom I'm not able to manage them on light sedation. Those are the patients whom I might go for paralysis. So apart from that, routine care of the patient is there, which is going in any ICU, is going in COVID ICU also, head up position, ulcer prophylaxis, sugar control is very well demonstrated on just a nice lecture taken by Dr. Bhalla. We also do, juggle with have problems with sugar glucose control. And because we are giving very high dose of steroids, sometimes, 500 milligram steroids is being given to prevent the HLS syndrome. So those patients, really, we have to, struggle with sugar management. So apart from that, the routine management of the patient, it's also taken care of. So, and this is a very important aspect, the psychosocial support of the patient, the staff, and, the relatives. So, what is happening, the patients, the relatives are not allowed to come inside. And we all know the subset of the patients we have and the subset of the relatives we have, it is really a very important task that we are able to, manage the families along with the patient easily. And, communication is the key here. So for doing communication, what we have done is we are taking use of the smartphone and the tablet. And we have fixed time for our patient. We allow the patient to be, do video conferencing. And with families also, we are in constant touch and we are continuously trying to allay the fear of the relatives and also of the patient. Because, we all know that once the patient is in ICU, it really becomes tough for the family, that whether they will be able to see their patient again or not. So for all these things, we are using the technology. So now coming to the life-threatening situations, we are having, a multiple n number of life-threatening situations. And as we all are very much aware that COVID is really playing with our, the whole knowledge. And COVID is just throwing multiple kind of googlies to us. So let it be, viral myocarditis. So many times we are having patients who are just coming, shifting from ward with a severe, complete ST elevation MI. And like we lose the patient in like 30 minutes. Then coming the dreaded cytokine storm. I think we all dread this complete cytokine storm. So to manage this cytokine storm, already Dr. Manisha has elaborated beautifully the drugs which we are using. So we are trying to use, a combination of various, a medley of drugs. So we are also not sure which is working. We're just trying hard. I think the whole world is just trying at this time and the evidence is pouring in. And as the evidence is pouring in, we are very much sure that steroids are really the, main hero of this whole COVID drama. So pulmonary hypertension might occur and the right heart failure might occur. And apart from that, multi-organ dysfunction is occurring. Sometimes secondary bacterial sepsis is also occurring. Though it is rare occurrence, but yes, we do have one or two cases we had of severe sepsis also. So, and apart from that, even we had certain cases of Guillain-Barré syndrome. One patient we had of Guillain-Barré syndrome, which we managed pretty well and we were able to send him home. So neurological involvement is also occurring. And unfortunately, we had a very, young patient whom we struggled very hard. We intubated, we extubated the patient, but eventually we lost him to a major stroke. So these kind of things are occurring in the ICU, and we are trying to manage the patients on a daily basis. So I would like to enumerate again the complications. We all are aware of that. We are looking continuously at the D-dimer, which is because so much abnormal clotting is occurring. So the patient might have DVT, the patient might have DIC, he might have stroke, he might have myocarditis. This is all because of the abnormal clotting cascade which is occurring. As I already told you, we have an acute COVID cardiovascular syndrome, which can lead to heart failure, pericardial effusion, and acute coronary syndrome also. Then ARDS, which we are managing. And this ARDS, I will tell you, it's really quite different from the earlier ARDS, which I have been managing for so many years. And the dreaded cytokine storm, which can even lead to macrophage activation syndrome, and again leading to DIC shock and multi-organ dysfunction. So coming to the most important aspect of critical care management, which is the management of the oxygenation and the ventilation. See now, the most important thing is the saturation of the oxygen. See, what saturation are we targeting here? See now, COVID has actually, given us some new targets. Earlier, the targets were very much like 92% to 96%, and still today, we believe that this is actually the target for normal patients. We should target the oxygen 92 to 96 if it is achievable, if we are able to achieve this. But the problem here is that we are not able to achieve these targets. So So if you are an expert clinician, you may choose your targets, and but just make sure tailor these targets to your individual patient. Please don't make a one shoe size fit all. Don't make one size that yes, I will target 80 saturation or will target 78 saturation. See, have an expert, you know, tailored target for your patient. If your patient is a case of COPD, maybe yes, I'm happy with 88. If it is a, you know, a case is a young boy who's pulling well and all the organs are doing good, maybe I'm happy with 82, 84. But yes, if I know that this patient is too frail and will get respiratory fatigue, so I might not, you know, go for such lower targets. So when you're choosing the targets, please tailor your targets. Don't fix. One shoe size doesn't fit all and doesn't fit in COVID also. So coming to the various oxygen devices. So there are multiple types of oxygen devices which you can choose. Again, starting from the nasal prongs, and I would say that because the dead space is less to more than 6 liters, it doesn't help. But again, the same thing when you are using any oxygen device, let it be nasal prong, let it be face mask, make sure you decrease the aerosol generation. That can be simply done by putting a surgical face mask on the patient after you put the prongs or after you put the face mask. So the number of aerosols which are getting generated, they actually decrease pretty much, the number comes down. Then we have other options. We have the high flow nasal cannula, and then we have the high NIV, non-invasive ventilation. And last but not the least, we have the ventilator, which I think everyone has been dreading so far, that they don't want their patient to go on ventilator because it is like writing a death sentence, which I don't know, maybe still more data is pouring in. And we also had some cases, so we will also discuss those cases. So the risk of viral transmission, we know aerosols are getting generated. If you use NIV, if you use HFNC, whatever you are using, aerosol is getting generated. So how to prevent that? So what we are doing in our practices, if I'm using an NIV, I'm using the interface should be tight. If you're putting an NIV on the patient's face, just make sure you make a tight seal so that, you know, the generation of the aerosol doesn't occur. And HFNC, it doesn't lead to much aerosol formation because it has got very high flow. So the generation of aerosols is pretty not that much high. So HFNC is, you don't need to do anything much great with HFNC. So for the coming to the suggested approach, the same thing is NIV, if you're using, you have to use cautiously. And if the patient is hypoxemic, CPAP might be used. And if your patient is not improving, so this is actually the thing which we really need to take care of. If the patient is not improving despite all these measures, please don't hesitate. Don't hesitate to take your patient on ventilator. So the suggest again, the same thing. We use a combination of all these things. So now coming to the intubation of a critically ill patient. This is the topic which I would really like to discuss because once we have decided that I want to intubate this patient, how to go ahead with this. See, most of the times we are pretty late in intubating our patients because, see, we are trying everything. Maybe we are trying steroids. Maybe we are thinking today we are giving plasma, tomorrow the patient will get better. Or might be we are thinking that, yes, let's just wait for some more time. So when we get to intubate a patient, actually, the patient is on 100% FiO2, and most of the times the lungs are fibrosed. And the patient hardly has any reserve. So it's really a major challenge. And that too, that we have to intubate in a single go because you have to have a real expert because we don't want to expose our healthcare workers also. So pre-oxygenation is the key. If you can pre-oxygenate your patient on the NIV, that really helps. And after that, I generally, what I try to use is really short acting drugs. So I will just show a small video here, which is enumerate how to, you know, tube these patients. Just a minute, I will take for that. I'm not able to get that, sorry. Some problems is occurring in the, okay. I'm not able to get that. Maybe I'll try to get it later on. In the end of this presentation, I'll show you. So basically, the concept which I want to tell you is, first of all, take your patient on an NIV. What I do is take my patient on NIV and with a tight interface, 100% FiO2. Along with that, I get everything ready. I get all my drugs ready. And then if, suppose I'm intubating the patient and if we have a PAPR, which we have made in-house, I use that PAPR because it makes my life easy and there's no fogging. So fogging is a major issue when we are intubating. And then we have made a C circuit. Suppose if I have to ventilate my patient, I use a C circuit, and we have used viral filters at all the ends. So this viral filter, even if I'm ventilating my patient closely, the viral filter will prevent the jet of virus coming to my face. So these are certain precautions which we do, and we definitely do have a video laryngoscope, and we have an ambuscope in case of difficult ventilation. Now, coming to the debate, whether which patient should be intubated and which patient should not be intubated, I will be talking about the basic physiology. And in that, I will go through the various phenotypes and the genotypes. And the phenotypes has really been a talk earlier when I was junior. I always used to think, you know, this is not of much use. But COVID has actually, you know, clarified this thing that the phenotype is really very important in deciding the course of the patient and deciding how you want to ventilate that patient. So this is why this is the diagram is by Gattinonin et al. And it has been published in Intensive Care Medicine. And as you can see, there are two types of phenotypes which he has described, type L and type H. So if you see the type L, here you can see the lungs are very clear. But my friends, don't go on the clear lungs. These patients are generally very highly hypoxic. So if you think the X-ray is clear and you don't want to intubate this patient, please think again. These patients will be really very hypoxic, and you will lose your patient within a matter of 6 to 10 hours. So these patients, they have a low elastance, they have a low ventilation to perfusion ratio, they have low lung weight, and they have low recruitability. You can give them a trial of high flow, CPAP, NIV, but if the hypoxemia doesn't resolve, please go ahead and tube them. Because if you don't tube, despite being this X-ray, which you might say the patches are really small, the patient is not going to make it. Then coming to the type H, this is a type H in which you have high elastance, you have high right to left shunt, high lung weight, and high recruitability. So this is a patient, if I give good amount of PEEP, definitely I'll be able to recruit the lungs. If I do prone position, I will be able to recruit the lungs. So this is the type H. And some very interesting presentation has come up in this journal, and they have made it like into three types, phenotype 1, phenotype 2, and phenotype 3. And I'm showing you this because just now Dr. Mintz has presented beautifully some cases where he showed, you know, really nice COVID lungs and how we manage those lungs. So coming to these three phenotypes, this is the phenotype where you have multiple focal, possibly over-perfused ground glass opacity. So here you have a very good lung compliance. And if I tube this patient, I do not need really very high PEEP. Low PEEP will suffice in this patient. And moderate PEEP actually helps. And this is a subset of the patient where you can try inhaled nitric oxide. Though I don't have it at this particular facility, but if you have, this is the patient who will actually, you know, respond to inhaled nitric oxide. Then comes to the phenotype 2. Here, basically what is happening is lots of atelectasis is occurring here. So this is the patient where moderate to high PEEP will help the patient. The lateral position and prone position. I had a patient who was really very obese, and so I could not actually prone him. But lateral position really helped that patient to, you know, mitigate all the hypoxia. It really increased the, you know, FiO2 saturation to like more than 10 to 15 when I used to use lateral position. And this is the phenotype 3, the patchy ARDS, when the complete lung involvement is there. So here alveolar edema is there, low compliance is there. Ventilator setting should follow the general principle of ARDS, which we have been following for ages. In this, what we use is very high PEEP and low tidal volume and 1:1 IE ratio. So these are the patients. Any three phenotypes can be there. But this phenotype 1 is actually the most dangerous because here we are taken unaware. We generally say the X-ray is not that bad or the CT is not that bad. So now coming to how to progress and when you intubate these patients. Suppose if I have a patient here at the spectrum and the elastance is low. So if I have the patient is here, so at that point of time, maybe I can try the high flow nasal cannula, CPAP, or an NIV. So if we decide to go for an early intubation, if my patient is not improving and I do get to intubate the patient early, I would like to use low PEEP, 5 to 10 PEEP. Suppose I get a patient who's really late into the disease and the lungs are completely fibrosed. At that point of time, I would have to really go with really high PEEP, prone positioning, and maybe we have to think of ECMO. And earlier, the better. Please don't go for an ECMO once the lungs are completely fibrosed. Then we have to go for lung transplant. And it makes no sense. Suppose if we have to go for these modalities like ECMO, if you're thinking of saving some precious life, we have to act really fast. Suppose we have a phenotype H and we know that the patient is going in failure. Act fast, intubate the patient, shift for ECMO. That should be the real norm. So coming to the management part, which I've already discussed. So the targets of oxygen are, again, we target really 88 to 90 is my saturation target. Generally, these are the targets which I follow. Apart from that, permissive hypercarbia is the rule. I will permit hypercarbia till the time the pH is under control. But if pH is going high, and if my patient's lungs is fibrosed, I may accept high peak pressures also. And sometimes if your patient is obese, please do target the peak flat and go for the driving pressure. So this is a concept in which we really need to take care of the driving pressure in obese patients or in whom the chest wall is really fibrotic. So these are certain recommendations which have been given by various societies, Society of Critical Care, and I've always followed the European Society. I've been always following them. And according to them, again, the same thing. In mild ARDS, moderate ARDS, they have given certain guidelines, which we try to follow most of the time. I will deal with the moderate to severe ARDS. We try to avoid the neuromuscular blocker. But if my patient is really hypoxemic and I have to prone my patient, I do use them. I sedate, I paralyze, I prone my patient. And we do recruitment maneuvers also. And we systemic steroids we are already using. So these are certain things which we do in our patients. So most of the societies have similar guidelines. So coming to the management of a critically ill patient, I think this will answer the question whether to ventilate or not to ventilate. This is an article which has been recently published in 6th June. This is not an old article that when it was said earlier, it was the norm that ventilate. Later, it's the norm not to ventilate. Let's see what this article has to say. And this is from the critical care experts from Wuhan. And so what they say, if you have a critical patient and if you have a PaFiO2 ratio less than 150, go for endotracheal intubation and apply all the kind of lung protective ventilator strategy, recruit the lungs, do the peak titration, prone positioning and ECMO. But if you have PF ratio which is more than 150, these are the subset you can try NIV or HFNC. And in these patients also, the trial of NIV and HFNC has to be really a guarded one. Again, the same thing I'll insist, one shoe size doesn't fit all. If your patient is severely hypoxemic, if your patient is doing silly, this is one term which will I again tell you, self-inflicted lung injury. This will occur in the patients who are a phenotype L, means the lungs are not recruitable there, but the patient is going to draw a volume of 1 liter, 1.2 liters with each breath. So what is happening here is self-inflicted lung injury. So if the patient is going to draw this much high volumes and in the baby lungs, a kind of, again, you know, a cytokine storm and biotrauma is occurring, which will lead the patient to go into a storm, cytokine storm. So you have to prevent that thing also. For that, what you have to do, again, go for elective intubation. I'm not happy if my patient is having a respiratory rate of 18 and a tidal volume of 1 liter, because I know this patient is, you know, this is a trouble patient. In these patients, please be careful and take early steps. Otherwise, you will lose the patient. Then the time is gone. A fibrosed lung, I cannot open and no one else can open. So if you're using HFNC, you have to see the index. The index is between the saturation and the flow which you are giving. So it is, if it is 4.88, it's fine. If 3.85 and 4.8, it's a mild category. If again, you are using very high flows and completely high FiO2, it's a time to intubate. So these are the things. Though I'm sure we are not getting very good results even after intubation. I am proning, I'm supining, I'm using all the my expertise. But still, the results are really not very, you know, heartwarming. But anyways, results are not in our hands. But doing the things correctly and properly is the thing we can do. So this is when I prone my patients. These are the this is a checklist which I follow. And see, if you are planning to prone patients in your ICU, I will say first thing is to train and teach the staff. This is the really the staff forms the, you know, the pillars of proning. So you have to really train and teach them. And this proning is a very simple maneuver which can be easily done bedside by 6 trained, or maybe if you have 2 trained doctors, and if you train 4 of your staff, 6 people can easily do it. And the thing what is required is just a 6 pillow and a silicone ring, which we require. So suppose that this is a patient who is prone, I will be using 6 pillows, 2 pillows in the chest, 2 pillows in the pelvic region, 2 pillows at the knee region. And apart from that, just make sure the abdomen is, you know, getting with each and every breath, the abdomen is hanging free. There should be some space between the bed and the abdomen. Abdomen should not get, you know, congested. So this is the thing. Airway control is there important. And this is a complete checklist. If you can download this, and it actually helps you to prone the patient. Do all the things like you have to check for the pressure source. You have to disconnect the rise tube. You have to disconnect the unnecessary infusion pumps. Okay, so these are the things. And one more important thing. I always do is take a consent. Without taking a consent, I never prone my patients. Because if I prone a hypoxic patient and my patient arrests there, though in COVID they encourage you to do a prone CPR, but still, it is a hazard. So proning is a hazard, and I always take a written consent from the relatives, and I always explain them that this is the next thing we are going to do. And I generally prone my patient for 16 hours, and it really gives good results. Sometimes 2 to 3 proning is what all it takes. So we had a complicated case which was sent to us by Dr. Suman. He was a case of acute leukemia, ALL. We were actually able to take that patient out. We weaned the patient off from ventilator. We intervened on the team, intubated the patient. We extubated the patient. But after 15 days, we lost that patient to the disease process of leukemia. But anyways, these are the lessons which we are learning every day. And as COVID is really something which is not a daily thing coming our way. A difficult virus, I will say. Coming to the extubation part, yes, we have extubated a couple of patients and sent them to ward. Sometimes they have come back to us because extubation is pretty difficult again in COVID because it is the fibrosis which is there. And even a small amount of change, even if a person gets a little liquid or some fluids are given more, lungs get flooded because of the fibrosis, hypoxemia increase, and the patient comes back. So extubation has to be really guarded. Your patient should be maintaining pretty well. Then only you should try to extubate. It should be a conscious, awake patient. He should have adequate cuff reflex. Excess of secretion should not be there. He should be maintaining a saturation of 90% on FiO2 of 0.4. Pressure support, generally I do 10 by 4 or 5 PEEP is what I allow. And maximum inspiratory pressure should be able to generate a negative inspiratory pressure. So these are the certain things which we are doing in our ICU, and we are trying to pull our patients out. So juggling between starting from oxygen cannula, to oxygen face mask, to non-rebreathing mask, coming to high flow, using NIV, coming to intubations, proning them, managing the relatives, managing the doctors, the rota, everything has been, completely a roller coaster ride here. So I would like to thank you all for your patient listening. And over to Dr. Gupta, sir. Sir.
Thank you, Dr. Shikha. You have done a job very elaborately. Right from mild diseases to severe diseases, whether to ventilate, how to ventilate, how to ventilate, how to extubate. Everything has been very, very well discussed by you. Now I request Dr. Sanjeev Kapoor to please take over and hold the question answer session and also give us the take home messages. We'll request all the participants to please type your questions in the chat box. Dr. Kapoor can go through the chat box and have the questions answered by the expert panel. Dr. Kapoor, please. Dr. Kapoor is a senior consultant, head of the Department of Medicine at the QRG Health City. He's a very, very senior person. He's over to Dr. Kapoor, please.
Thank you, Rakesh. Thank you very much. And welcome everybody on the board today evening. We had very good lecture from all of you. My predecessors, they have done a very wonderful job. Some of the lectures have been extraordinary, I would say. That has made my job very, very easy. So let's go into this next slide. Right. So this is a multi-organ disorder which has been characterized by thromboinflammation, mainly the pulmonary. So this is a concept which has come up that mainly involves the lungs only. That's not really true. In fact, almost all the organs are getting involved, which contribute to the mortality and morbidity. We have to identify those high-risk patients, these patients who are going to do worse, who are going to be worse in our clinic, having a worse clinical course over a period of time. So that's number one when a patient comes to you. Identify those high-risk patients so that they can be taken care of. Age more than 60, patients having comorbidity. Coronary artery disease, congestive heart failure, whether fully controlled or uncontrolled. Patients with a CVA, especially in the last 6 months, chronic obstructive airway disease, patient with morbid obesity, patient with obstructive sleep apnea syndrome, of course, diabetics, chronic lung conditions, hypertension, various cancers, patients with the transplant patients, patients who are on immunosuppression, patients with chronic kidney disease or decompensated liver disease. These are the patients which are going to do bad in the clinical course when they are coming with COVID to the hospital. Next slide, please. As I said, it is involving most of the organs of the body, though the emphasis is mainly on the pulmonary involvement. Substantial pulmonary involvement includes atypical pneumonia, ARDS, as we had a lot of good cases and a lot of CT scans which you have seen. However, extra pulmonary manifestations, as shown by, I think, Dr. Mins in two of his cases, they are equally important and contribute significantly to the morbidity and mortality of these patients. So I'll enumerate some of the important ones, extra pulmonary manifestations. You are having arterial venous thrombosis, especially thrombosis of the pulmonary vasculature. But as you see in one of the cases shown by Dr. Mins, superior mesenteric artery getting blocked because of this. We have had a patient of pulmonary embolism in mind, had a patient of stroke because of this, had a patient of myocardial infarction because of this. All these cases are because of arterial or venous thrombosis. Similarly, you can have mesenteric ischemia, you can have limb ischemia, DVTs, and various various manifestations of these arterial and venous thrombosis. Cytokine storm syndrome has been discussed. Coagulopathy is something which is well known. And some of the common laboratory hematologic abnormalities like lymphopenia and very interesting patient, almost like ITP, or it could have been missed as like a patient of dengue syndrome, where you had what Dr. Mins presented, one of the very nice cases, 60s. Then cardiovascular, we discussed, we have had acute coronary syndromes in these patients, subcutaneous, sudden cardiac death, acute carpulmonale because of pulmonary hypertension, various arrhythmias, atrial fibrillation has been discussed. We had supraventricular tachycardia in one of our patients, long-standing congestive cardiac failure, cardiomyopathy, and some of these patients do present with cardiogenic shock. Next. Renal, GI, and endocrine, these are the other organs which get involved. These are the common things which we normally see in our ICU, but they don't really contribute much to the mortality in these patients. What causes mortality is mainly cardiovascular and the respiratory. Common GI manifestations, which we know, ajusia, we know about nausea, vomiting, diarrhea. This is another thing. Diarrhea is another something which is important. Many of these patients, we had three patients who presented just with acute gastroenteritis, and they were not getting well. We really discussed and went up to sigmoidoscopy in these patients, and finally it came that they were COVID positive. Mesenteric ischemia has been well documented in the recent case. Dr. Bhalla has discussed quite nicely about hyperglycemic states, especially the euglycemic ketosis, even in the patients who are not on SGLT2 inhibitors. Next, please. We have had one of our colleagues, our chest specialist, Dr. I will not name on the forum, but he suffered from Guillain-Barré syndrome, and we had to treat him with IVIG. So that is something which is not to be forgotten, that you get these symptoms. We are having patients with chronic fatigue syndrome, patients coming with psychiatric morbidities. In fact, some of the staff members, after having suffered from this, they're having psychiatric comorbidities. COVID toes, you are very well clear of, everybody knows about it. Ophthalmological, there has been case reports of central retinal vein thrombosis. So this disease is not only pulmonary, it is a multi-system disorder which affects most of the organs, but cardiovascular and the pulmonary manifestations, these are the ones which are causing most of the mortality. Next, please. This is very important when you're sitting in the OPD, whether this patient is going mild, is moderate, severe, or is critical. Severe critical, there's no problem. The problem lies when you when you have a patient who's getting a mild disease, whether he'll get into moderate or not, you are not sure on that particular day or on that particular visit. Once you know how to really classify, once you have a saturation which is going down below 90%, then your patient is most likely it is getting into severe. Mild, you are able to recognize and you send them back to home for home quarantine and ask them to work. The most important thing which I find in my practice, and now it has been published as well, is a 6-minute walk test, or in elderly people, maybe even 3-minute walk test. In case there's no contraindication to do this test, very extremely important and very helpful test in the general practice, when to admit a patient, when not to admit patient, when to send this patient home. Okay, you go home and keep on doing your tests. what I do in my practice is I tell them, okay, buy a, in case it's a mild patient, I tell them, okay, buy a pulse oximeter twice a day, keep on doing your, this, you know, 6-minute walk test or whatever you can do. But in case, supposing you get unduly tired or you your saturation start falling more than 3%, okay, stop the test and inform me immediately. That is the time we call them, okay, now you can't be home quarantined, you need to come back to the hospital. Similarly, those patients who are recovering in the ward, we almost, those patients who are not on oxygen and are comfortable, we do them, we do a 6-minute walk test almost on a daily basis in these patients. And those patients who can carry out the 6-minute walk test in next couple of days or so, probably they would be able to discharge unless nothing else really prevents them from getting discharged. So this is one test which I recommend to my patients, to my colleagues, to my, you know, people who are working in the field. I will tell them, just do this test. This will help you a lot in the long way. Next, please. These are the diagnostic tests which have been, you know, already discussed. There's nothing much to be discussed. COVID antibody is not diagnostic for that. We know that. All of us know that it is not to be, not for diagnostic. It is for serological surveys. One thing in all these things we have been discussed, pro-BNP has been discussed, TROPI has been discussed. One thing which I like to point out about the is about IL-6. We have had some patients who are very comfortable. In fact, one of my colleagues who was very comfortable got a corona and has got his IL-6 down. It went to up to 83 at the night, and he almost rushed from his home back to, you know, he rushed to hospital and called me up. We went through the literature. He was very comfortable. Then we found out that in case your serum is kept for more than an hour or so, the IL-6 levels go up. We have had two patients, husband and wife, in which the IL-6 was more than 2000 and they were absolutely comfortable. So one should be very careful in assessing IL-6. Just not that IL-6 is high, okay, let's go for tocilizumab. No, that's not true. You, as a whole, the patient needs to be, you know, assessed. Next, please. These things, I think, have been discussed very nicely by the by Dr. Manisha Mendiratta. I don't think I need to elaborate much. Question is, various antivirals, are they different? To my mind, they're all same. Yes, except remdesivir is very costly. The second drug, which has probably not been discussed, is a combination of this, what comes by the name lopinavir and ritonavir. I find this drug to be quite useful in my practice. It is given for two capsules twice a day for almost 10 to 14 days. To my mind, see, this drug works quite well. Like any other antivirals, to my mind, they are not different. Only thing, cost is different. More studies have been probably carried out in remdesivir. This is the other drug, favipiravir. Next, please. This part, I think, has been discussed extremely well by my previous speaker. I don't need to dwell on that. A lot of controversy about plasma. The problem with plasma is that we are not getting very clear-cut guidelines from anybody. Whatsoever is anecdotal reports, we talked to our colleagues, somebody says it has worked very well. At times it has not worked. But I think the last slide shown by Dr. Manisha Mendiratta, that says it all. Use, if you want to use it, use early. Probably it might be used. Next, please. This is something which now we have started seeing. Post-COVID complications, something has been discussed about post-COVID pulmonary fibrosis and persistent dyspnea at rest even after 2 weeks, 3 weeks, 4 weeks, and we are having now these patients. I would little different with Dr. Mins, what was mentioned, if I heard correctly, that they are you're using the antifibrotics very early in the disease. Recently, I was going through one of the symposium from Molyneux Institute and from others also. Probably these drugs are not indicated in the early part, but then we might have a little difference of opinion there. Two drugs, nothing to choose between them, either nintedanib or the other one is pirfenidone. Probably it has to be used a little later, and the effect will come in about 2 to 3 months if it comes in these patients. Psychiatric issues, low quality of life, post-intensive care syndrome, chronic fatigue syndrome. These are things which you are likely to see in next year or so. We have already started seeing, and we will get more and more of that. Post-discharge pulmonary embolism, critical care neuromyopathy, the various cardiovascular complications, superadded bacterial infections after discharge in those, what we saw in one of the cases. And we must think of alternative etiologies of recurrence of fever. Don't think that dengue is not there. Don't think scrub typhus is not there or enteric fever is died down. This is another, nowadays, of course, we are seeing most of the patients with COVID, with fever, we tend to rule it out. But all the same, other causes of fever are still in the society. We are still seeing cases. Please do not miss them in the early. Next, please. Now, lesser we said, we say about the vaccine, I think better it is, because still a long way to go about the successful vaccine. You have all heard in the last 3-4 days, so Russia gave vaccine to some of the people, and then now in Oxford trial, one person developed this transverse myelitis. And I think it is too early to say about the vaccine. In my, you know, what I understand about vaccine, probably we'll have it at the end of middle or end of next year. Success in that. Thank you very much. Thank you. A very nice academic program today. Thanks, Ashu. Thanks, Rakesh. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Dr. Sanjeev. I'll request you to please handle the question answer session as well. You have very nicely summarized the whole symposium which we have done today under the aegis of API Faridabad, which we wanted to rekindle, and we'll be doing the activities a little more frequently on different aspects.
Unmute.
Sorry, I have unmuted, right. Sure. So we have got questions. You can go to chat box to have some questions. I have got 2 questions from one Dr. J.K. Gulati and one more. Please go through chat box and let's have the...
Not finding.
So let me tell you the question. One is Dr. J.K. Gulati is asking, okay, how much is the risk of what is the life of antibodies which we develop into a patient? How long do they last and how effective are they are for how much time? This is Dr. Gulati from Yanwanagar, your friend.
Welcome, Juginder. See, the answer to this question is not very clear as of now. These are neutralizing antibodies, and we do not still know what is the role of cell-mediated immunity in these patients. We are seeing, we will gain probably more and more experience about this as we, you know, do more and more tests about this, about the seroprevalence. The answer is not very clear in some of these patients why there is reinfection. Documented reinfection after 3 months. Where are the antibodies in those cases? So the answer is probably not clear. How long the antibodies last? Probably there are papers, they say 4 to 6 months. But already we are into the epidemic only for the last 4 to 6 months only. How do we know that? How long? We need a longer period of observation in due course of time. Then probably we'll be able to answer this question.
Sir, can I add a point here?
Sure.
Sir, so there are 2 parts to this question. The first part is how long the antibodies last, and do these antibodies prevent us from reinfection? So as you rightly mentioned, the answer to the first question is, if you go by the data that we have, NAGM last week published that in Iceland, they did a seroserology study in the population that's been affected. And they know that at least for 4 months it is there, because that's long how the epidemic has been seen in these countries. It doesn't die off after 4 months in majority of the patients. In some patients, it goes down to negligible levels till they have some immunity to reinfection. Now, the second part is reinfection has been seen in Hong Kong and US, documented with different serotypes. But what they found was these were people who were RT-PCR positive, but never generated adequate number of antibodies. So antibodies, your immediate immune response to an intruder. So if you have poor antibody response, you have a chance of reinfection. It is not very common.
Well, thank you, Himanshu, for that. I have one small question from my side. Use of steroids, the studies are with the dexamethasone, but we are using methylprednisolone to a very large extent. Is there any difference in the efficacy of these two steroids or preparations? And which should be preferred steroid?
Okay, go on, Himanshu.
No, sir, please. Sorry, sir. I just thought.
See, my personal opinion is there is hardly any difference. But in case we go pharmacologically, dexamethasone, the anti-inflammatory power of dexamethasone is this and this is similar type of doses, like 7.5 versus 20, what we see, in the, what have been taught in the pharmacological classes. It is betamethasone and dexamethasone. They are more anti-inflammatory, this and this, methylprednisolone. But since the advent of this drug and being used particularly in rheumatology, the solimedrol or methylprednisolone has got more popularity among the. Dexamethasone has now become a poorer cousin, but it is equally effective if used in the right doses. What WH has done a trial on 6 milligram part for 5 days, or now they say even up to 10 days. That duration, I don't seem to agree. It depends on clinician to clinician. Like in one of the patients, Dr. Mins has used 500 milligram. So you need to really think out of the box, which patient requires how much dose of steroids. Even in some of the OPD patients where you're not very sure and patient doesn't want to get admitted, okay, 6 milligram dexamethasone or a prednisone tablet, say 4 to 16 milligram, may say 8 to 16 milligram might do the job. But in patients with ICU, I think the doses will be variant, but dexamethasone, solimedrol, I feel both are safe.
I have one more question. Should we give ecosprin or a similar drug for next 2-3 months post-COVID in view of the delayed complications? This is Dr. Pratul Pradarshi. So please, somebody can take up the question.
Certainly, I agree with that. See, there is a lot of thrombosis. In initial part, you have used maybe for 5 to 10 days these drugs. Now, there are papers which are coming up whether to use direct oral anticoagulants in documented patients, like this patient with a mesenteric thrombosis. You will not leave this patient after say about 10 to 14 days once the patient leaves you. I think this patient will require long-term controls. Similarly, those patients who are in high risk, somebody having a coronary artery disease, somebody having a stroke or previous stroke, the role of aspirin or other drugs, antiplatelets, is must. There is no harm will be done in continuing these drugs for a period of, say, maybe 4 to 6 weeks or even more.
Yeah. Dr. Shikha, I wanted to make a comment and ask a question. Dr. Shikha can ask the question directly to Dr. Sanjeev.
Yes, sir. My question is regarding the long haulers. Like, how many patients are we actually getting back returning us to in our OPDs? Because in ICU, we do not get...
Sorry, I can't hear you. Please repeat your question.
Can you hear me?
Yeah,
please.
Yes. So my question is regarding the long haulers. So how many patients are coming back in your clinical setup, once they recover from COVID? And how many of them are actually, landing in pulmonary fibrosis, which is incapacitating them from their daily to day-to-day work?
All these patients, they definitely come for follow-up. So the follow-up is almost 100%. There's no doubt. Most of them, they get well. I have some patients, maybe 2 or 3 patients whom I have started now perfenidine in these patients.
Okay. And have you used N-acetylcysteine, sir, in these patients? There are some studies which are showing that N-acetylcysteine does help with the patients who, get repeated attacks of breathlessness and, tiredness and weakness.
No, I have not used them.
Okay, thank you, sir. And Dr. Mins, sir, if you can just, answer this question.
See, most of them come back and their associated morbidity hasn't been so bad as such. And I have been following them very keenly, right, with repeated CTs and PFTs. So even though the PFTs have shown mild to moderate diffusion and restrictive defect, but in the quality of life vis-a-vis the activities of daily life, none of them have been hampered so far.
Okay. Right. Thank you, sir. Thank you so much.
Yeah, sure. Any more questions from anybody? Or should I call Dr. Sumant Gupta for presenting a vote of thanks? And I must thank Sumant and his team who have organized today's CME technically. The platform has been provided by Sumant only, along with his associate, Ravindra, who has been hosting us all. So if there are no further questions, then I request Dr. Sumant Gupta. Yeah, Dr. Sanjeev, please.
Dr. Rakesh, can I ask a question?
Yeah, please.
Okay.
Hello?
Yes.
Yeah, what are the definite indications of use of remdesivir and what time it should be started?
I'll pass it on to Dr. Arvind Mins, please. Dr. Mins, please.
Sir, in the absence of any definitive protocols, we have been using remdesivir more of in moderate to severe diseases. The idea here was let's do away with the viral clearing and splitting it into two parts. Do away with the viral clearing and take care of the immune-mediated lung destruction. Since I've been using a lot of steroids, much on a higher doses, I was more comfortable using it more often than not. With the fact that let's clear it off and then go ahead and take care of the destruction happening secondary to the immune processes. Hello?
Yeah.
Can I add a point here, sir?
Sure,
please. Please. Go ahead.
So the indication, as you rightly said, is moderate to severe, not mild patients. Mm. Now, the other very important thing that people have to understand is it doesn't work after day 9. So viral replication has already stopped after day 9.
Exactly.
So if you get a patient late, so there's no point of giving remdesivir. The other point is, remdesivir is the only experimental drug allowed to be used in COVID. The other problem that we face with remdesivir is that patient tolerance is poor. A lot of time you start them on remdesivir and you see that LFTs on day 3 or day 4 have gone haywire and you have to stop. But they still get better. So what I'm trying to say is that rather than the viral clearance, which is going to happen by itself, it may be slightly delayed by the use of steroids. If you are able to use steroids, you are going to get better, irrespective of the fact you are able to give them antivirals or you were unable to give it for some reason or the other.
Yeah, I agree with you, Manju. The fact is, since we have been, let's split the COVID pneumonia into two. Our initial trigger, secondary to viral, and which leads to acute lung, just like any other acute interstitial lung. That reflects very much, very clearly vis-a-vis the prothrombotic states, vis-a-vis the CSS. So the thought process which generates from here is of corona per se as a virus is just acts as a trigger for as any drug-related acute interstitial lung would be.
So, sir, it would be difficult to differentiate. The transaminitis is per se because of the COVID, ongoing COVID virus infection, or it is because of the remdesivir. So if the transaminitis is not in a progressive trend, we can monitor LFTs for another 2 days before stopping remdesivir, considering that it is leading to transaminitis.
And the transient transaminitis we've had was acceptable so far. Like, we never went into very, very steep transaminitis. And rightly said, Manisha, it could have been a part of disease, which definitely settles down more often than not.
Yeah, so we haven't stopped remdesivir in any of our
because
of the transaminitis.
Neither have I ever.
So, Dr. Sumant, please come over.
Can I? Rakesh?
Yeah, sure. Sure, Dr. Please.
Just about, one point about this LFT. What is mentioned in the literature is, in case your OTPT don't cross 5 times the upper limit of the normal.
Exactly, sir.
So you can continue with that. So something around 200 units, in case your upper limit of normal is 40, then it is comfortably, you can continue with your remdesivir. Two. I have two more observations and one important point for the general, you know, physicians who are attending this. One is the role of CT, when to really use it. X-ray can be really deceptive in these patients. If somebody having cough and the X-ray can be deceptive, in case you do their NCCT, non-contrast CT, lot many times, 80% of the cases, you will find some patches. So X-ray is not a good investigation vis-a-vis a non-contrast CT, which should be done early, the threshold to do a CT scan should be low. That is something. One.
That's a point.
Second thing I wanted to mention.
Can we use a 6-minute walk test as a good indicator?
Sorry?
Can a 6-minute walk test be a good indicator? Because CT might not be available at all the places. Suppose the patient is...
Certainly. See, since we are working in Faridabad, we have access, we are all in corporate hospitals. But 6-minute walk test, and practically it's a very good test, even for the, which I recommend even to the patient. They, all of them, they buy their pulse oximeters and keep on informing me morning and evening on WhatsApp. One thing about... One just observation about, again, I'm rekindling one of the, you know, the controversy about HCQS. My observation is, see, I am practicing a lot of rheumatology in my practice, and over the last 20 years, I've accumulated maybe 2,000 or 3,000 patients of rheumatology and follow-up. But interestingly, I did not find a single patient coming with COVID to my clinic or under my admission in the last 4 to 5 months. The question is, they were all on HCQS. Is HCQS protective or is it just a flu?
Sir, I would just hear jet in rather. The same holds true with people who have had a suppressed immune systems. People with renal transplant fared well. People on chemo who have the disease under process fared well. People who have been otherwise also on immunosuppressant fared very well rather. And agreed, yes, I truly agreed with you. I never had anybody with autoimmune disorder on the CQS coming up for with COVID. And of interest is, again, maybe it's a localized in the observation, a negative correlation between smoking and COVID patients.
We have one
There's
more question.
Trial to support that.
Yeah. We have one more question from the audience. They say, is there an indication of repeating a CT or a follow-up CT, more so after remdesivir therapy or like that?
Yeah, do it. Come, Zambina, Sunday phone.
Can you take this question?
Sure, Machare.
Yeah, my question is that is there an indication of repeating a CT or a follow-up CT, especially more so after the remdesivir therapy? Is it going to be useful? Dr. Kapoor can answer that question.
I think let Shikha or Himanshu.
Yeah, sure, way. Himanshu. Let Himanshu. Or sir. Dr. Balla. Yeah. Dr. Balla, would you like to take up the question?
In ICU, though, we are not able to get a CT scan done repeatedly. So we are not using CT as an indicator there. We do have a baseline CT, which sometimes the patient comes with. But, you know, sending the patients repeatedly to CT scan actually doesn't serve our purpose. So we don't regularly subject our patient from ICU to a CT. But we do monitor other parameters like PF ratio, then peak pressures, the requirement of FiO2. So those indicators actually give us a very good, you know, hint that whether the patient is improving or is not improving. So we don't do regularly repeated CTs. But yes, if some gross thing is happening, we'll send.
So the recommendation here would say that you do first CT if possible between day 2 to day 5, day 3 to day 5, and then you can follow up the patient with serial x-rays. You don't need to go for a serial CT, as Shikha rightly said, because you have so many other parameters to monitor. The reason for a repeat CT would be if you're thinking something else, you're thinking of barotrauma, you're thinking of embolism, you're thinking of some other pathology that's crept in. So just to follow the patient and the lung shadows, you might not need a repeat CT.
I just want to add one thing, sir. These are the patients who are on ventilator and definitely cannot be shifted again. But if you're coming to the original question as posed, does CT helps deciding the whatever remdesivir has done to? Now, remdesivir is working on a very different level over here. It's as an antiviral. So if you want to see a resolution because of remdesivir, that looks pretty unlikely because happening over there. But yes, I have been liberal with my patients with CTs, both as an initial diagnostic modality, because it gives me a result in 5 minutes rather than waiting for RT-PCR, since the sensitivity is much higher than RT-PCR. And I have been following up with more of CTs, looking at the worsening or clearing of it. But then that's my individual thing.
Sure, I think we come to the end of the session, and I must thank all the participants, all the learned speakers, Dr. Bhalla, Dr. Miz, Dr. Shikha, Dr. Kapoor, Dr. Manisha, and I must thank in absentia Dr. Sumant, whose battery power has gone off and is not able to come to the platform, to thank everybody, and who has been the core architect of today's session. He has designed all the topics, he has discussed with all the speakers, he has coordinated with all the speakers. So I must thank Dr. Sumant Gupta and his team from the core of my heart. And I believe that in the next few weeks, we'll be having a repeat session on some of the other topic. And look at Dr. Sanjeev Kapoor, Dr. Bhalla, Dr. Mains, Dr. Manisha, to please contribute to the next sessions of API, Faridabad sessions. And I believe that we are always there to be on the platform of API Haryana as well. So with this thing, I thank everybody, all the participants, all the team members, and wish you all a very good night. Thank you. Bye.
Thank you. Thank you. Good night. Good night.